once again. We come into your presence with expectancy in our hearts. God, we know you're going to bless us. So we lift our hands in the sanctuary and we give you glory and honor and praise. Come on, come on.
We lift our hands in the sanctuary. We lift our hands to give you the glory. We lift our hands to give you the praise. And we will praise you for the rest of our days.
Yes,
yes. We will praise you for the rest of our days.
We lift our hands.
We lift our hands in the sanctuary.
We lift our hands.
The Storehouse Ministry is asking for volunteers to help with food packing, loading cars, and directing traffic. This is a great opportunity to share God's love and generosity with our neighbors. If you are ready to lend a hand, please go to tcww.org to sign up.
The Biggest Loser Contest is a weight loss competition designed to encourage and support participants in achieving their fitness and wellness goals. The contest will include individuals looking for fellowship and healthy competition among participants. To register, you can visit recreation.tcww.org.
Join us for our Spring Fest Community Health and Wellness Symposium. This is a fun and informative event for the whole family with basketball tournaments, rides, games, and food trucks. Get health screenings and free supplies. Donate blood or plasma. Explore nutrition, mental health, and fitness. Be a part of insightful sessions covering colorectal health, diabetes prevention, and advanced weight loss options. Participate in MD Anderson's Faith, Families Aiming Towards Health, a six-month plan that helps families reach and sustain a healthy weight. Qualifying families get paid to lose weight. So bring your family and friends on Saturday, April 13th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. at the Eldridge Campus for our Spring Fest Community Health and Wellness Symposium. For more information, please go to healthwellness.tcww.org.
Greetings, motorsport community, foodies, family, friend. Greetings to all. This year, we're thrilled to host our annual Cookout and Chrome event here at our Queenston campus on April 20th from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Join us for delicious food, fun, fellowship, and an exciting car show. Remember to register today at tcww.org, or you can scan the QR code. You know the rest. Don't meet me there.
Hi, I'm Pastor Ralph Douglas West. Here's an invitation for you to join me in Houston, Texas, April the 23rd to the 25th for the IC3 Church Conference. The IC3 Church Conference is your opportunity to connect, learn, and grow with fellow pastors and leaders from around the nation. This year, our theme is Strengthening What Remains, and we've designed an incredible lineup of breakout sessions to empower your staff and ministry leaders. Taking ownership of your membership, using AI in church, handling conflict constructively, Reimagining Christian Education, Grant Resources 101, Thriving in the Digital Age. The IC3 Church Conference is where inspiration meets innovation and where we come together to strengthen what remains. Don't miss out on this incredible chance to transform your church and community. Join us in Houston, Texas from April the 23rd to the 25th. Register today at IC3ChurchConference.org.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He reigns on high.
I got his love.
Somebody just give him praise. Come on, lift up your hands and give him praise, church.
Hallelujah.
He's won the victory.
Hallelujah.
He's alive. Tell somebody he's alive. He's alive. Come on, somebody celebrate him.
Hallelujah. Salvation and glory and power belong to our God. He who was dead is alive again. He who said it is finished has now come to say, fear not, the Lord is here. He reigns forever and ever and ever, and we reign with him, King Jesus.
Almighty God, may the rising of your only begotten Son raise new life and new hope in us. Grant that we too may be examples of your love so strong that we become the change we want to see in the world. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
The Old Testament scripture is Psalms 100. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs. Know that the Lord is God.
Yes, Lord.
It is he who made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good.
Yes, Lord.
And his love endures forever. Yes. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
Amen.
The New Testament scripture is Matthew chapter 28, 1 through 7. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay, and then go quickly and tell his disciples, 'He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you.'" This is the word of God.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in reading the litany. Jesus, fully man and fully God, lived a sinless life, yet he died on the cross for all humanity's sins.
All of our sins, my sins, died at Calvary on that cross.
Jesus, who was fully man, bled and died. Jesus, who was fully God, rose from death and the grave.
This is the gift of salvation. Jesus died in my place to save me from my sins. And he rose again to give me new life.
If I confess that Jesus, fully man and fully God, has risen from the dead, and if I believe in my heart that Jesus is Lord, I am saved.
Jesus, I believe. Forgive me for all I have done wrong. Please be Lord of my life.
Jesus, fully man, knows and understands my needs. Jesus, fully God, is the way to life, the truth in life, and the life everlasting.
Because Jesus lives, I live. I am not a slave to sin. I am forgiven. I am victorious. Hallelujah.
Let us pray. Father, we praise you for being our creator, who knew us before we were born, our Savior who died for our sins, our risen Lord who gave us the gift of eternal life. Thank you for another day of brand new blessings and giving us victory over every battle. Oh God, please forgive us of our sins and draw us closer to you even now. Open our hearts to receive your word that has the power to transform our lives. We pray for peace and relief aid in the midst of war. We pray for asylum seekers, migrants, and the pastors serving them at the border. We pray for the families who lost loved ones on the Baltimore Bridge. We pray, God, that you give us, and we thank you for releasing the children kidnapped in Nigeria. Lord, comfort our bereaved families, Rosie Martin, the family of Richard Wyatt, the family of Bobby Mae Sandoz, Barbara Winfield Ford, Julia and Freddie Lee, Christine Blackshire, Kevin, Kenneth and Beverly Sanders, Justin Sanders, Amber Hamilton, Jackie Washington, Cynthia and Gerald Jones, Essie Dillard, Pamela and Hansel Evans, Kenesha Evans, Esther Lita Roberts, Jackie Washington, and Tony Davis. Thank you, Lord, for our pastor, Ralph Douglas West, Sister Sharita West, and their family. Please bless them for all they do for our people. Please bless our church, staff, leadership, first-time friends, and guests. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There is something about that name. We want you to join and sing with us. Come on. See, Jesus.
Jesus.
Call his name.
Jesus.
Oh, Jesus.
Jesus.
Yes, Lord. Lift your hands and say, there is something in.
There is something
about. Say,
about.
That name. Anybody know Jesus? Come on, can we call his name? Say, Master. He's Savior. Come on, lift up your hands and say, Jesus. Oh, Lord. Light the fragrance. Light the fragrance.
After
the rain. Somebody help me call his name. Jesus. Call his name. Oh, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Jesus, I need you to lift it up. Come on, say, Jesus, say,
Jesus.
Yeah.
Jesus.
We call your name.
Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
And Jesus.
just praise the name of Jesus. Come on, somebody just praise the name of Jesus. Somebody just lift up your hands and praise the name of Jesus. What an awesome God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Can somebody just help me praise the name of Jesus? Amen. We have a wonderful hymn for you this morning. Christ the Lord is risen today. Anybody glad that the Lord rose? Come on, that's the reason why we're saved today. Christ the Lord is risen today. Christ. Sons of men.
Sons of men and angels sing.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Raise your joys. Come on.
Raise your joys and triumphs.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Sing ye heavens. Verse 2, lives again, come on.
Lives again, our glorious King.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Where, O death?
Where, O death, is now thy sting.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Dying ones, come on, join in.
Dying ones,
hallelujah. Where's thy victory? Come on.
Where's thy victory, O great? Hallelujah.
Verse 3, love's redeeming work. Come on.
Love's redeeming work is done.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Fought the fight. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on, real big. Death in vain. Come on. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Christ is open.
Christ has opened.
Verse number 4.
Sing we to our God above.
Praise eternal, come on, church.
Praise eternal as his love.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Real big, praise him all, say.
Praise him all.
Hallelujah. Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, come on.
Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Somebody clap your hands. Christ our Lord is risen today. Somebody give his name the praise.
Happy Resurrection Day, church. You may be seated. What a great day to be here. What a great day to welcome some very special people that are joining us today. If you are joining us for the very first time, we call you our first-time friends. If that's you, would you please wave your hand? Matt, hey, just stand on up. First-time friend. I'll see you back there. Stand on up. Let's see you. Glad to have you. Amen. Glad to have you. Good to see y'all this morning. You're looking good. You're looking good. We cannot wait to get a chance to meet you. We will join up immediately after the invitation. We'll answer any questions that you have. We'll pray with you, encourage you, and just welcome you into our family. Amen, church?
Well, we have some other special people that are streaming all the way from South Africa, Canada, France, India, Iceland, and even Italy. Well, we have some wedding anniversaries to recognize. Brother and sister Floyd and Sean Briggs have been married for 30 years. Brother and sister Eric and Francis Spann, 31 years. And brother and sister Virgil and Belinda Akers, 40 years. We still going. Brother and sister Donald and Tracy Kitchen, 52 years. And get this, brother and sister Larry and Claudine Mouton, 59 years. Amen. Well, church, I know you've been waiting all year to get to Sunday morning, so let's not even hesitate. Get on up, move around, encourage each other. Peace be with you.
Come on, my Lord, get there always singing the song. Come and win, oh my Lord, Jesus is
together. Come on, come on, come on. Hey, choir, one more time. See, forever the harmony.
Forever and ever.
Give his name the glory, church. Hallelujah. Any worshipers in the building? Anybody just love the Lord? Can you just lift up your hands if you love him? What a mighty God we serve. We want to sing this worship song. You are God, the only sovereign God, everlasting, ever loving, ever giving. If you love the Lord, just lift your hand just for a moment and say, God, I love you. God, I praise you. We worship your name in this place. There's nobody like you. You are God.
The only
Together on this Resurrection Sunday. Come on, keep those hands together. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Hey, thank you so much, choir, for blessing us. And thank you so much also to our liturgical team for blessing us this morning. Let's give them all a hand clap of encouragement. For a few moments, if you will, open your Bibles to the book of Ephesians. Paul's letter to the Ephesian church, the book of Ephesians, chapter 2. Chapter 2, verse 8. And I want to lay emphasis on this one verse this morning. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, the word of God says, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this not from yourselves, it is the gift of God.
This is the word of God. You may be seated. For a few moments this morning, this Resurrection Sunday, I want to tag this text, a priceless gift. A priceless gift. One of the longtime church members here, who's a jewel salesman and who has a specialty in diamonds, I could never afford any of his jewelry, but I was always curious about his occupation. I would see all the different stones that he would sell in his store, but I got a great lesson in learning about the dimensions of diamonds. He told me, he said, "Ralph, let me show you something. You like those princess cuts?" "Yes, I do. I really appreciate them." But then he did something I'd never seen before. He went into his bag and he pulled out the diamond and he lifted it up to the sun. He said, "You see that?" I said, "Yeah." "You notice the different colors and the cuts?" I said, "Yeah." "But watch this." Then he went into that same bag and pulled out a black cloth. And when he put the diamond on the backdrop of the black cloth, I really got a chance to see the beauties of the dimensions of the diamond. It wasn't for the dark backdrop could I see the bright dimensions in the diamond. You know, in the very same way, that's what the good news of Jesus Christ is like. The good news is only good news because of the dark drop of the bad news. I know that's an unconventional way to start off a sermon in 2024, especially on Easter Sunday, when we're here to celebrate the good news. But the good news is only good because the bad news is so bad. And I want to start off today addressing really some bad news. Some of you might be like me. When someone has something to tell you, I got some good news and I got some bad news, I'd often say, "Give me the bad news first." Well, the fact of the matter is that there is some bad news that all of us have to confront. But before we get to it, the reality is on this day, each and every one of us have an opportunity to make the most important decision of our lives. I know all of us are from different ages and different backgrounds, but the one thing all of us have in common is that every day of our life, we have to make some decision. Now, if I were to ask you, what's the most important decision you've ever made? Maybe some would say the most important decision I ever made was what school I would go to. Or maybe some would say the most important decision I made was where I would work. Or maybe you would say the most important decision I ever made was who I would marry. But today we will have the opportunity to make the most important decision of our life. But what do you mean? Well, first let me give you the bad news about the good news. The fact is that all of us have to face the enormity of sin. I know that's not a word we use much in church these days. We like to gloss over it, talking about mistakes, mishaps, stumblings. But let's be very clear, this Easter Sunday is a celebration day, not because of mistakes, mishaps, and stumblings, but is because of what God did about the issue of the enormity of sin. It's a three-letter word, one syllable, and a lot of us don't like to use it. Many of us don't say it in church anymore. But in the eyesight of God, God cannot be in the face or the presence of sin. It's just like a person who has OCD and they walk into a room and the picture is crooked and they have to put it back into place. Or like an archer who's aiming at the target, but they miss the mark. I mean, all of us look at different, not all of us, but many of us pay attention to athletic competitions, and you see how the athletes may miss the mark. That's what sin is. But let me put it to you another way. What if you committed one sin each day of your life? That's 365 sins in 1 year. And a span of 10 years, what's that? That's 3,600. I'm messing up my math. But let me put it into another term. Let me take away the word sin. Let's say you had traffic tickets. Let's say you had 365 traffic tickets. Now, you can come across the best judge, the nicest judge, who's a family member who couldn't forgive something like that. But what does it really look like? It seems like, you know, it's not a big deal. Well, here's another picture of it in a more lighter terms. Walt Disney, the brainchild of Disney World, he wanted to give an illustration, and he took different mouse traps. He went into one of the playrooms on his grounds, and he set hundreds of mouse traps on the ground. But then he took ping pong balls and placed them gently on the traps after they've been loaded. He went into another room and threw the ping pong balls in the room, and you already know what happened. One ping pong ball made one trap go off, and one trap caused five, and five caused 20, and there was just chaos in the room. And that's how sin is. Just one thought sets off one trap of emotion, and one trap of emotion sets off another word, and it just begins to be chaos in the human being. The scripture says that we were born and shaped in iniquity. And that is a reality for all of us, that there is an enormity of sin. There is no little sin. But let me get a little bit darker. Not only is there the enormity of sin, all of us must face the certainty of death. Hebrews 9:27 says, just as people are destined to die. I'm not sure how punctual you are. I know confession is good for the soul, bad for the reputation. I have a tendency to be late every now and again. But the fact is, there is one appointment that none of us can be late for. There's one appointment all of us have no choice but to make. And throughout scripture, there are only two people that bypassed death. That was Enoch and Elijah. Growing up in this church for more than 36 years and then preaching for 20, growing up here, whenever there's a funeral, these aren't just members but family, people I've gone to their homes, grew up in school, church, Sunday school, church, with their children. And then I'd actually have to stand over their casket and give the eulogies. And it's been heartbreaking to see how so many people, even in this church, have died from meaningless murders, shot by random gunfire, or even some that have had to, who were under the dark cloud to decide to take their own life. The fact is, those are days that always remind me of the certainty of death. William Sauron says, I always thought that an exception would be made to me at the moment of death. Believe it or not, there are a lot of us that live like that. We look on television and say, that happens to them, that's not going to happen to me. David Shields, in his book, is called The Thing About Life is One Day You Will Be Dead. At the time he wrote the book, he was 51. His father was 87 years old. and he's trying to reconcile the meaning and significance of death. He said, one day my dad will be dead, and one day so will I. And I find both facts overwhelming. That's a sobering fact to sit down and say, one day I'll be dead. You know, people take trips to Alexandria in Egypt to see the pyramids, but they forget that those pyramids are tombs for kings. There's a certainty about death. Tony Campolo said, you know, one day you'll be put in a box, and the box will be put in a box, and the people will go back to the church and eat chicken talking about how you're in a box. The fact we must face is there is the enormity of sin, the certainty of death. But let me give you one more. There is the reality of judgment. In the scripture, it says the book will be open. The books of books will be open. I'm not just talking about a book like Harry Potter novels, no. But the book for each and every one of us will be open that has documentations of every day of our lives, documenting every thought, every word, every action, and every deed. And everything we've ever done in our life has been recorded in the book. And one day the book on you will be open. Everything has been recorded. We have to give an account for that. William Shakespeare once said, one thing that great guilt has run its course, but when danger, death, or detection is near, it stings us again. He's saying that great guilt after some time may pass, but when there's death, danger, or detection, everything you've ever done seems to rise to the surface all over again. Some of us here in the choir a few weeks ago took a flight to Birmingham, Alabama, and it was a stormy weekend that weekend. And I remember being on the flight, and that plane was shaking and rocking. And while we're in flight, it was taking some unexpected dips in air. And let me tell you something, church, I never heard so much prayer. While we were mid-flight. And I couldn't help but to think of the words of William Shakespeare, that when there's death, danger, or detection, guilt rises and stings us again. There's the reality of the judgment, that we have to give an account for all that we've done. But you know what? I'm not the brightest, but I'm smart enough to know that there's some people here saying, you know what, I don't like that. I don't like what that says. I don't care for that. Well, if you don't like what the scripture says, you can do like Thomas Jefferson. Thomas Jefferson, you can look it up. You can Google it today. Thomas Jefferson literally made his own Bible. And he went into the Bible and cut out the things he didn't like. He cut out the miracles, and he cut out the resurrection, and put together his own Bible. And I like to call something like that Dalmatian theology. I'll pick a spot, and I'll gloss over another spot, and I'll pick this spot, and I'll go over this spot. And some of us attempt to do that very same thing. I like this part of the Bible, but I don't like this part of the Bible. But the fact of the matter is that all of us must face the reality of judgment. Somebody's like, ooh, all right now, preacher, this is dark on Easter Sunday. But the fact is, there's the enormity of our sin, the certainty of death, and judgment that we all must face. But I told you that diamond had to be on the back, black backdrop. But keep this in mind. The bad news is so bad because the good news is so good. And in the light of the enormity of sin, the certainty of death and the reality of judgment, the good news is that we have total sufficiency in Jesus Christ. Paul says that he came bearing our sins. Jesus lived a totally perfect and sinless life. Jesus would stand before the Pharisees, Sadducees, and people in his neighborhood and said to them, "Who among you can accuse me of any sin?" I mean, can you imagine any of you in here being in front of people that know you and saying to them, "Tell me what you can accuse me of"? I don't think you would want to ask that question out loud. But Jesus lived a totally perfect and sinless life. No one could claim that. Many of us, we can't even fathom something like that. And because of Jesus' perfection, have you noticed that of all of the religions, Jesus makes people so uncomfortable? I mean, the moment you say his name, people start to twitching and moving. Nobody picks at Muhammad. Nobody has commentary of Buddha. Nobody uses Hindu gods and curse words. But Jesus makes everybody uncomfortable. I mean, even to the point, have you ever gone in a public place and tried to read your Bible? And when you read your Bible, you walk in, it's like people automatically know what you have. It's almost like you have a bomb in your hand. It gets people uncomfortable and it gets everybody's attention. Jesus lived a perfect life. Who among you can say that I've committed any fault? And we can't conceive something like that, which means because he lived a perfect life, he was the only one qualified to be the perfect sacrifice. Because he was perfect, he was the perfect sacrifice for an imperfect people like you and me. I told you the bad news is only bad because the good news is so good. What's so good about this news? Jesus stood in a line for people whose life have been out of line. When Jesus was 30 years old, in Matthew chapter 3, his cousin John the Baptist, that wasn't his last name, but John the Baptizer, was having a baptism ceremony. And at the Jordan River, there was a line of people that were standing in line to be baptized. But those people that Jesus stood in line with, keep in mind, he lived a perfect life, but he was in line with some imperfect people. Behind him, he had a liar. In front of him, he had a drug dealer. Before, in front of them, there was a drug abuser. In front of them was a prostitute. Behind him was a Roman soldier. But Jesus stood in line with people whose life had been out of line. But keep in mind, he lived a perfect life. But the mere fact that he was in line, you ever gone to those conventions? And those conventions, they give you name tags. And those name tags that had your name. Well, in that line, those people had to wear their sin on them. But because Jesus lived a perfect life, and he got in a line he did not have to stand in, it was as though he was taking their name tags and pulling it off of them and putting it on him, and he was baptizing it, showing them that because I am perfect, I can take on the sins of an imperfect people. He stood in a line that he did not have to stand in. But can I tell you something else about the good news? He died on a cross that he did not belong on. He was found to be without fault before the government officials, and they nailed him to a cross. All of us know that the Christian symbol is the cross. We move too quickly to that because we overlook how during the Roman, this period of time, that to even say the word cross was vulgar and derogatory. They would call it the C word. It was the most heinous and shameful death to see anyone hanging on a cross. But Jesus, he was without sin and was hanging on that cross. And as he's standing between two thieves, one thief is provoking him, but the other thief saw that he was without sin and said, "This man doesn't belong here. We belong here." And Jesus was on that cross as your substitute and your substitute and my substitute. He was on a cross that he did not belong on. And while he was being nailed to that cross, the first things that he said while he was on there was, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they're doing." But while he was on that cross, one thief said to him, "Jesus, remember me when you get into your kingdom." And for a few moments, the old preacher said that Jesus put death on hold and told him, and said, "On this day, you will be with me in paradise." He stood in a line he didn't have to stand in. And he died on a cross that he did not belong on. But then he laid in a tomb he did not belong in. He was put in a tomb, a borrowed tomb, and it was sealed. And several Roman soldiers were surrounding it to protect it, to make sure nobody would try and steal his body. But early Sunday morning, something happened. The earth began to quake, and that door opened up in that tomb. And the first witnesses, the first preachers of the gospel were some women when the angel told them, "He is not here, but he is alive." He was not in the tomb. And then when his disciples went in the tomb, they saw that it was empty. Jesus got up from the grave because he was in a tomb he did not belong in, and God got him up out of the grave, and it was the receipt that he got the vindication that he deserved. He got up out of a tomb he did not belong in. That good news for you and I is that because he got up from that tomb, you and I don't have to look at death as a dead end anymore, but it is now a doorway to eternity with him. When he got up out of the grave, you and I can get up as well. In other words, if you don't have a problem bigger than a dead Jesus, you don't have that big of a problem. That sounds like good news to me. He got in a line that he didn't belong in. He died on a cross he didn't belong on. And he got up out of a tomb that he didn't belong in. And he got up for you and for I. You know, some people might even say, "You know what, that's all, that sounds good and fine, preacher, but you know, I don't think I really need Jesus. Some people believe that. And you're saying, you know, I can get into heaven based on my own merit, based on my own action, what I've done. But I remember hearing a story from a Sunday school teacher talking about a man that died and went to the gates of heaven. You know, these stories always start the same way. This man died and went to heaven at the gate of heaven, and Peter was there. And the man said, "Well, I'm going to get into heaven based on my own credit." And Peter said, "All right, go ahead." The man says, "Well, I'm going to get in on my own merit." Peter says, "Well, all right, if you want to get in, you have to make 100 points. "Fine, I can do that, Peter. I have never cheated on my taxes." "That sounds nice. I'll give you 1 point. "I taught Sunday school, half a point." "I've never thought of cheating on my wife." "You're supposed to do that anyway." 1 point. And the man kept going down the line, reciting everything he's ever done. And by the time he was done, he didn't even get to 10 points. And Peter said to him, "That's all you have left?" And the man said to Peter, "If I don't have the grace of God, I can't get in." And at that moment, Peter said, "Well, come on in, because we can only enter into his kingdom by the gift of his grace." Now, everything that I'm saying, I'm sure there's still some here and some watching says, you know what, preacher, that sounds nice, but I'm just not really convinced. Well, okay, because you are a logical people, let me put it to you this way. Let's say that out of everything that I've said, everything that I've preached, everything that Pastor West preaches when it comes to the good news, let's say that there's a 10% chance that I'm right. Say that 90% of what I'm saying I'm wrong, but there's just 10% chance I'm right. What you're saying is like, this doesn't sound too good. It looks like the odds in my favor. Let me put it to you this way. Let's say that there were 10 flights leaving out of Hobby or Bush Airlines. And one out of every 10 flights, there was certain to be a crash. Now, would you still get on the plane? Absolutely not. There's a chance that what I'm saying is right. Why would you want to gamble with your life when the Lord says, I have a free gift that is priceless just for you? All you have to do is accept it. But you know what? I looked up the world's most expensive gifts, and it was an impressive list. And on that top 10 list, I looked at the top three. And number three, in 1972, on her 40th birthday, Elizabeth Taylor would receive what is known as the Taylor Diamond. It was a $1 million diamond, one of the most expensive gifts in the world. Number two, it was the gift that King Abdullah gifted to President Barack Obama. And the gift, it was some gold, it was some precious stones, rubies, and diamonds. But the number one most expensive gift in the world, it was the gift given by Shahan Jafan to his wife. And it took 22 years to build this, 22 years and 32 million Indian rupees to build this gift. And it's one of the wonders that people travel around the world to see it. It's the Taj Mahal. But people forget the Taj Mahal is nothing but a tomb. But when I looked at that list, they left a greater gift off that list. There's a more costly gift off that list. It's a priceless gift. You don't have to have a birthday to get it. You don't have to become president, receive it, and you can still be alive and still have it. It's the grace and the gift of salvation in Jesus Christ. And because he's alive today and he lives today, he can still extend that gift of grace, of forgiveness and salvation to you today. All you have to do is receive it while you still have breath in your body, while he's here now to give it to you. Amen. Amen. The priceless gift of grace and salvation is here for you right now. Our leaders are going to stand in the aisle, and the choir is going to sing, and we want to extend the invitation to you. Very simple. If you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, he's saying, if you're here right now and you still have breath in your body, you have an opportunity right now to receive that gift. All you have to do is accept it. What do you mean? For you to say, Jesus, I want you to be my personal Lord, my personal Savior. Not my mama, not my grandfather, not my grandmother, but my Lord and Savior. That's the first invitation. Second invitation, maybe you're here and you're saying, you know, I've strayed away from the faith and I don't read the Bible like I should. I don't go to church like I need to, but I want to get myself together, my affairs in order. Listen, if you're trying to get yourself together by yourself, you will never get it together. But listen, all of us are in here right now, not because we could get ourselves together, but because we're held together by the grace of Jesus Christ. And Jesus said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. And he said that knowing that there's a chance that we might leave or forsake him. And so the second invitation on this Resurrection Sunday is for you to come back to him. Third invitation, maybe you don't have a church home. And you're saying, you know, I have different reasons why I don't have a church home. I relocated, or I've been watching online, and you know, I just don't like to be around a lot of people, this, that, and other. Listen, whatever reason or excuse, you already know if it's right to be in the church, it's wrong to be outside of the church. Just like a fish can't survive outside of water, a believer cannot survive nor thrive separated and isolated from the body of Christ. So the leaders are standing and the choir is going to sing. And on this day, we want to encourage you to receive the priceless gift of salvation and grace, to get up from your seat and walk down the aisle, because the Lord is waiting on you right now. Amen. Extend another invitation this morning. And you're here, you know that the Lord is speaking to you. You know that he is irritating you underneath the skin and you can't come up with an excuse good enough. But at the same time, maybe somebody else is here and you want to get up, you want to give your life to Christ, but you hear a voice telling you, just wait. This fifth Sunday, wait until first Sunday. Or wait until the next Sunday. Now, I promise you, I'm not the type of preacher to try to scare anybody. But I don't have to show you in the scripture where it says that tomorrow is not promised. You see that every day on your alerts on your phone, on the television. But right now, the Lord is saying, you live in an uncertain world. Let me secure your tomorrow today. So on this Lord's Day, help me out with this invitation. I can't reach some of the people next to you. So look to your neighbor, to your left and right, to your brother and sister, and just touch them and ask them, is the Lord waiting on you? I can't walk for you, but I'd love to walk with you. The name of the Lord. Ours to extend and yours to accept. If you would, extend your arms in direction of our sister this morning. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to say thank you. Thank you for a day we've never seen before and one we'll never see again. Lord, thank you for dying on our cross, getting in a tomb we should have been in. But Lord, we are so grateful that you raised your son Jesus up from the grave. Lord, we pray right now on this Resurrection Sunday for our sister, and thankful that she received your invitation. We pray right now that you would show her the gifts that you've put inside of her so she can do her part in uplifting your kingdom. Remind her and each and every one of us, she's no longer a friend, but now family. And because she is now family, she's a part of the body of Christ. And now a part of the body of Christ, we travel down this road called life together. Lord, we thank you and we love you. Thank you for what you've done. Thank you for what you're doing. But we want to give you glory, honor, and praise right now for what you're about to do. In the powerful, majestic name of Jesus, let the church say together, amen. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise this morning. On this Sunday morning, let's prepare to worship the Lord through our thanksgiving, because God loves a what? A cheerful giver, amen. While you're preparing, I want to say thank you so much to each and every one of you that showed up and showed out on Monday, Thursday night, and then also on Good Friday worship, amen. Thank you so much for showing up, and we had a wonderful time in the Lord. Now, I don't like to rub nothing in, but if you weren't there Friday, you missed it. Oh, man. Amen. You have your gifts prepared and ready? Come on, let's wave them in the air. Let's say it together. Where there's a temple, there's a need. Where there's a need, there's provision. Where there's provision, there's God. And where there's God, he shall supply in miraculous ways. It's offering time.
The Church Without Walls has been engaging in an honoring and relational way, serving the community locally and internationally. Your giving to missions helps us to support local and international churches in evangelizing souls, discipling new believers to Jesus Christ, and practical everyday needs. This year, our missions ministry has partnered with more than 35 local organizations to support and meet the needs of underserved and under-resourced and homeless men, women, and children in the Houston area. Our volunteers participate weekly with in-person and virtual events. Some even drive for over an hour to serve and pray with those in need. We are excited about meeting new people and building new relationships while serving our local communities. Because of the Church Without Walls' generosity, the Cooperative Baptist Fellowship, CBF, were able to join a collective of believers in understanding and experiencing how God is at work in the world. CBF field personnel work to help local businesses become sustainable in Uganda, advocate for literacy of indigenous children in Thailand, provide protective equipment, and support migrant farm workers in rural settlements in Africa. This year, 29 CBF chaplains and pastoral counselors were endorsed and commissioned. 5 new global missions personnel were commissioned. 1, to address the health needs of refugees in Larnaca, Cyprus, and serve as part of the Global Missions Africa Middle East team. 1, will work as a mental health educator with the Global Missions Europe team. 3, will serve through the Global Service Corps program to serve missions initiatives in the United States. Through our joint efforts with Fellowship Southwest, thousands have been served over the past 12 months. Here are a few things we are involved in. We have joined with Dr. Freddie Haynes to advocate for maternal health for Black women. A new migrant shelter was opened in the small village of La Modelo. A network of pastors serving migrants along the border feed, house, and protect migrants. Food distribution on the streets of Tijuana and Matamoros and church-run shelters in Piedras Negras provide migrants' health clinic services and COVID vaccinations. An old parsonage was renovated in Brownsville, expanding respite center capacity. 2 vans were purchased to safely transport migrants to shelters. Hundreds of Spanish Bibles have been purchased and handed out by the network pastors. One of the border pastors tells his story to CNN.
See this interview and other videos after service. When you give your tithes and offerings, you bear witness to Jesus Christ in the world. We thank you for supporting what God is doing in the lives of people through missions. And we invite you to join us in giving in our missions effort today at give.tcww.org. Or you can simply place it in the tray at the time of giving. There is joy in serving, and we have a service opportunity for everyone. Some opportunities are one time, others are year round. Opportunities are happening now, so please join the movement by going to our website and register to serve at mission.tcww.org. You make all the difference. Be encouraged.
Church family, at the beginning of worship, we wanted to welcome all of our first-time friends and visitors. But if today is your first time worshiping with us, we have something we want to give to you to let you know how much we appreciate you worshiping with us here. So if you would, first-time friends and visitors, please stand and walk out into the aisles toward our leaders with their arms outstretched to you. There's another and another and another. Come on, let's encourage in church. Thank you. We don't take your worshiping with us lightly here at the Church Without Walls Eldridge Campus. Amen? Amen. Stay in church if you will. Also at the end of service, to my right, your left, our leaders will be here if you want to have intercessory prayer. To my right and your left. I want to bless you before you go. The book of Numbers chapter 6, the Lord told Moses, Moses, tell Aaron this is how you are to bless the children. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and grant you his peace. When you rise up early and settle late, in your labor and in your leisure, in your laughter and in your tears, until that day when we shall stand at the feet of Jesus, where there's no sunrise or sunset. God bless you. Be encouraged.